We are gathered here over Zoom, and it is a pleasure to see you and to worship with you. My name, of course, is Moses, and as we enter into this fourth Sunday of Lent, I want to wish the peace of Christ on you. And as we do in most of our services, to begin to remind us of the presence of God with us, I invite you to light our peace lamps. So if you have a lamp at home that you would like to light with us, let's do that together now. May the peace of Christ be with you. I really miss seeing all of you in person, and knowing that things are starting to change, things are starting to shift. I hope that soon we will be able to gather again. But we are still over Zoom, and so we want to just take a moment to greet one another. So if you have the capacity to turn your view to gallery view, I'd invite you to do that. And let's just take a moment to see who's here and to give a wave to one another and greet each other here this morning. I'm going to pull up our call to worship, which we have been reading over this Lent season. And this call to worship is responsive, and I know it doesn't always feel like we're together, but we're going to try to unmute ourselves, if you're comfortable with that, to speak our call of worship together. There's a part for the leader and part for all of us and for the people. And so as we enter into this service, let us gather our thoughts and our minds and hearts to Jesus. Jesus calls us to praise and prayer, to song and silence.
Jesus calls us to worship.
Jesus calls us to hearing and healing, to service and solidarity.
Jesus calls us to love.
Jesus calls us to advocacy and action, to protest and provision.
Jesus calls us to justice.
We hear the call of Christ.
We worship together with joy.
Amen. Thank you for joining us in that call to worship. It's going to be a full week this week, actually a full season. So I've got a lot of announcements for us. Number one, we have a young adults event today at Kennedy's Place. They're doing an outdoor fire. So you can be in touch with Kennedy if you need any more information about that, or with me. You can also contact me. On Wednesday, we continue with our weekly Bible studies at 10 a.m. and all are welcome to join over Zoom as we look into the stories of Scripture. Then a couple events coming up in the next 2 weeks. Next Saturday on March 20th, we're going to have a Zoom session for our kids. We're going to do a crafting day. So all our kids, young kids, you would have received a care package with some prepared craft items and material to do an Easter garden. If you've already done it, that's okay. But we want to gather together on Zoom to do some of that together, or just to join and to see each other and to say hi to each other. So at 10 a.m. on Saturday, we're going to be doing that. And Michelle Stace is going to be leading us in that. And then the week after, for anybody who has ever wanted to learn how to make Pascha, I love eating Pascha, and knowing that on Easter Sunday we won't be sharing food together like we have really makes me want to learn how to make Pascha. So on Saturday, March 27th, also at 10 a.m., because there'll be some different stages, Doris Sawatsky-Dixon is going to be teaching us how to make Pascha over Zoom. So we'll send out some more information about how to gather ingredients and how to prepare, and then she's going to teach us over Zoom how to make Pascha. I got a lot of other events that I am going to, I'm going to drop our bulletin into the chat area. So you can take a look at that for other announcements and events coming up. And I'm also going to add our order of worship today into the chat area of Zoom so you can follow along. We are very pleased today to have with us Kathy Giesbrecht from Mennonite Church Manitoba, who's going to be delivering the sermon for us today. So welcome here, Kathy, and we look forward to hearing more from you and about you at the Church Manitoba annual delegate session last Saturday. And we heard so many good things, so many good reports from the staff who are working at Mennonite Church Manitoba and others who are involved. And so for our first song today, we're going to hear a song that was shared at the gathering, and it was recorded by the Faith and Life Men's Chorus or Choir. And so we're going to hear that song, and after that, just going to take a short snippet from the report from Michael Paul, who's the new executive minister of Mennonite Church Manitoba. And in there, we're going to see two very exciting new or renovated initiatives coming from our regional church. So, we're going to hear that song from the chorus, and then we're going to continue on that video and hear a short snippet from Michael's report.
Good morning, everyone. That was our Faith and Life male choir singing one of the hymns in our New Voices Together hymnal, Could It Be That God Is Singing? Our Faith and Life male choir may be recording in different ways these days, but in times past, they or similar groups would have recorded in churches or, as smaller ensembles, in this very space, the studio at the MCM offices in Winnipeg. You'll note that right now, there are renovations taking place. In conjunction with Mennonite Church Canada, work was done last year on the building to replace the HVAC system. In the process, mold was discovered in the studio ceiling, and this required some emergency work to remove the mold and rebuild the space. Typical 2020, things didn't go as planned. However, with the studio being rebuilt, we anticipate this being a hub for community music and recording, as well as a place of creative ministry among us as MCM for many years to come. Here's another sign of transition and change among us, our Circle of God's People radio program, which airs on three Golden West radio stations at 8:45 a.m. the second Sunday of every month. With Frohe Botschaft going off the air in 2020 after 64 years of radio ministry, We are pleased to see this radio initiative take root and grow. Take a look at what Circle of God's People is up to.
Hi, my name is Nadia Langelotz.
And I'm Claudia Duick.
We're the new hosts of Circle of God's People, a Mennonite Church Manitoba ministry. The show airs every second Sunday of the month at 8:45 a.m. on three of Golden West's radio stations, which will appear shortly on the screen in front of you.
On the show, you'll hear meditations, interviews, prayer, poetry, songs, and scripture. This past month, we interviewed Michael Paul, the new executive minister of Mennonite Church Manitoba.
Please tune in as you're able. We'd love to have you join us.
Most of my work in the first 2 months of my tenure has been the more mundane executive tasks, working through financial reports, working on budgets, finalizing lease agreements, dealing with mold in the ceiling. However, I have had some good opportunities to begin engaging with our congregations and congregational leaders, and I'm looking forward to more of this. I've joined some of our congregations in worship, sharing God's word with God's people. I'll be meeting with pastors from each of our four clusters during the month of March. And beyond that, over the next 18 months or so, I plan to make significant connections with each of the 39 congregations that collectively make up Mennonite Church Manitoba. I want to hear what God is up to among us, to learn what you are learning about God's presence and work among you and within your community. Out of this, we can discern together who we are as Mennonite Church Manitoba and who we can become. The collective work of MCM is grounded in the ministry of our local churches, but this has impact across the province, across the country, and even around the globe. We'll see some of this local, regional, national, and international ministry among us in the rest of my report and in the reports that follow. As an example of how we come together across our region to support one another, take a look at this intro to our Mennonite Women Manitoba Working Group, now rebranded as Woven.
Hello, my name is Bethany Bunko, and I am a part of Woven, formerly known as Mennonite Women Manitoba. We have chosen the name Woven to express our commitment to strengthen and support spaces and places of conversation, empowerment, and networking for women of all ages. In the last few years, we have hosted conversation circles, retreat days, resource tables, and created a CMU bursary for international Anabaptist women in leadership. This year, we are looking forward to offering both an online book study and conversation series. To learn more about us, please check out our Facebook page and join our email list to stay in touch. We look forward to connecting with you.
That's just a short sample of the reports that were shared at the Mennonite Church Manitoba gathering, and we want to make those available to you because I get very excited when I see the different initiatives taking place. Lot happening amongst our churches and with our camping ministry and of course other ministries as well. So we're going to be sharing with that with you this next week. Like I mentioned before, we are into the fourth Sunday of Lent. And as we have done for each Sunday of Lent, we focused on a time of confession, a time of prayer together as a community. And as it is the fourth Sunday of Lent, you'll see on our candles, we're going to be extinguishing four candles as we move to the darkness of Good Friday. So I invite you into a time of stillness, into a time of quiet, and then also into a time of prayer together. Let's pause. Let's speak together this prayer of confession. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, give us peace. Amen. This morning we have Kennedy Fraze leading us in the children's feature, and she is doing so by video because her internet connection is not stable today. So I'm going to pull that up and invite the kids to come and hear the message today from Kennedy.
It's Kennedy here. I am unfortunately in a place where Wi-Fi is a bit hit or miss this morning, so I hope I'm there in person with you, but I wanted to do this over video to make sure we could learn well together. So if all the kids want to pay attention as we think about Easter this morning and Lent, I just invite you to come closer to the screen. So today we are going to be talking about a passage in John, which is a gospel that talks about Jesus and his life. And so in John, we hear Jesus say he's on the cross. As you know, we've been talking about the cross a lot these past couple weeks. So once again, Jesus is on the cross, and he is talking to his mom and one of his good friends, John. And so Jesus says to John, "John, here is your mother," pointing at his own mom. And he does the same for his mom. He says, "Mom, this is your son," and he points to John. And so we are going to be looking at this idea of family that Jesus gives us. And he gives it to us in a way that probably would have been pretty unexpected in that time. You see, I don't know about you, but I really love my family. And when I think of my family, I think of maybe my mom and my dad, my siblings, my grandparents. And so we think of family kind of like this Russian nesting doll. These are created so that they have many dolls inside them, and they're supposed to represent all the generations of a family. So this is like your great-grandmother. Sticky one. And then your grandma, and then your mom, and then you. And so all of the family comes in order, and we see where the generations fall. But if this was you, Jesus turns to you and he says, "This is now also your mother." And so even though this is your birth mother, or this is who's raising you, you also are to treat this woman like your mother, and all of her children like family. And so Jesus encourages us to see more than just our own family as our family, but that everyone who follows Jesus is now our big family. And that's why when you go to Sunday school, you get taught by not just your parents, but by the entire community, because we believe that together we are one big family of God.
Thank you, Kennedy. Margaret Tahn is going to read our scripture this morning, which comes from John 19, and then Kathy Giesbrecht is going to bring the message. And of course, we are in our series of the last sayings of Jesus, and Kathy will be focusing on Jesus saying, "Here is your mother," and the text that goes with that. So Margaret, we invite you to share scripture.
I'll be reading from John 19, 25 to 27 from the NIV. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, the disciple took her into his home. The word of the Lord.
Hey, good morning. It's great to be with you again and great to sit in the scriptures with you. So thanks for the invite, and then thanks for letting me have the words I wanted. When I knew you were doing this series, I said, oh, I want these words, because I've always been drawn to them. So now I've got to sit with them for a longer time. So thanks. Thanks for giving me what I wanted on that. And I must say, you know, I've been a preacher for a long time, but I actually still get nervous, which is interesting. I think I take seriously what it means to be a minister of the gospel. But so I thought I would, to prepare myself, I went to last week's service and I listened to Kennedy's sermon. And now I'm even more nervous. Whoa, can that woman preach it? Holy smokes. I phoned her right away and I said, you go, girl. Like, that was such a great engagement with the scripture and just with good theology and then just good word for our community. And so now I'm even more nervous and I'm never going to follow Kennedy Phrase again in a preaching rotation. So just make a note there, your worship committee. Kathy Giesbrecht will not follow Kennedy because she just rocked it. And then, as usual, because I serve the wider church, I do keep an eye on congregations. And I was eyeing that for sure Tuesday, you guys were just like fooling around and having a comedian. So how great was that? I almost was going to transfer my membership. I'm a member at the Home Street Mennonite Church. We were not having a comedian. But I mean, thanks be to God, at least we were having a dessert swap so I could remain a member there at Home Street. But now I hear this morning that you're having Pascha lessons. So now I have to reconsider again whether I could remain at Home Street as opposed to, but maybe I could become, I think some churches have Moses, I think maybe I could be an associate member. So I could get all the passcodes, like to get in on all the good stuff happening over there. Anyway, all to say, that's a rather large, rather lengthy preamble. We do want to sit with the scripture. I'm going to set my timer. And when that rings, we'll just be done. I've never preached from sitting. I've never sat. So we'll see how this goes. I'll just set up my notes here. I love the Gospel of John. And particularly, I've always been drawn to these words. Woman, dear woman, says one translation, here is your son. So if you read the context, if you read just a bit before, you know, Jesus says this, you know he's already in excruciating pain. He's already been nailed to the cross. And amid the horror of this moment in his earthly life, he looks out and sees and speaks these absolutely compassionate and life-changing words. I've always found these words beautiful, but this time around when I sat with this scripture, they just became mind-blowing to me because there were three things in this, just these two, like, well, three verses, 25, 26, 27, three things I don't think I've ever noticed before. The first thing was, there's actually three Marys at the foot of the cross. I had never noticed before that Jesus's aunt was there. It was actually the wife of his father's brother. And I had to do a little research there. I didn't know who Mary, wife of Clopas, was. And so, you know, people have different opinions, like always. But I think I've landed that is actually his mother's sister-in-law and the wife of his father's brother. And so his aunt is also there with Mary Magdalene and his mother. And so his extended family actually was present. So why didn't he just say to his aunt, take care of your sister-in-law? Anyway, I began to wonder, as we do when we sit with scripture, right? The second thing I've never really noticed is it's a two phrase in 26 there. He doesn't stop with, woman, behold your son. Almost in the same breath, Jesus says, son, behold your mother. And there is this mutual entrusting. It's not just his mom, the widow. It is his grieving friend who he also acknowledges has a need. They needed each other. There's just not one person having a need going on here that Jesus sees. And that to me was, okay, so I had to think about that for at least half a day. And then I noticed it's the last line. It's sometimes in scripture, they almost like slip it in. You don't even kind of notice it sometimes. The last line in this particular Periscope passage is John immediately takes Mary into his home. Like boom, 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 right? He totally changes his household configuration, his economic situation, taking someone else into his care. He immediately takes Jesus seriously when Jesus entrusts something particular to him, and I just go, so once I noticed these three things, this passage for me took on a whole new level. Like it's always been beautiful. Okay, Jesus is dying and he looks out and takes care of his mom. Okay, if that's not beautiful enough about the heart of God, it just gets so much bigger when you sit with this. So I wondered, how would Jesus's words have sounded to these three women who were there witnessing this atrocity? And I think they must have just thought, he sees us. We see him. Obviously, people were there witnessing the crucifixion of these three, and particularly the one that had the sign, King of the Jews. But not only were people witnessing Jesus, he was seeing them. And he was not oblivious that his choice to go to the cross had repercussions for the people who loved him. That just blows me away. Here he is, nailed to the cross. Painful, we know these things. And yet he realizes that his choice to say yes to the will of God had repercussions for the people who had loved him throughout life, who had followed him in loyalty. And he saw them and he spoke to them. That's just crazy love and lesson for all of us. Because being seen, and I gave a sermon on being seen actually in my home congregation, Home Street, a number of months ago, is one of the most powerful gifts we in the body of Christ give each other. I'm a single adult. I think I've given actually a sermon on singleness right there at Sterling. I do. I've been with you a few times. It wasn't my last one, but somewhere in your archives, I think I've spoken on singleness. Yeah, Moses. Thank you, Moses, for the nod. Yeah. And so I'm a single adult. I live on my own. And a number of years ago, my cat, Abigail, died. And always when a pet dies, that is a loss for a household, a loss for a family. But when you live alone, it takes on a different feeling. And because my body of Christ I belong to, my congregation sees me and knows me. They know where I live. Maybe that's not so good. They know who I am. They know I have a cat. And they sent me a sympathy card. And at first, I kind of laughed. I thought, all those home streeters sending me a sympathy card about my cat. And then I wept. Because I said in my heart to myself, they see me. They see who I am, where I live, what has happened to me, and they recognize my sorrow. And it was huge. I renewed my membership immediately, and I probably even sent in another offering, because when you belong to a body of Christ that so knows you and sees you and realize you're vulnerable and what you're vulnerable to, I wasn't vulnerable. I wasn't going to lose my house because my cat died. I wasn't going to have enough supper because my cat died. I was going to lose my company, and they got it. And when the body of Christ gets it, when we get it about each other, it is powerful. We are given to each other is what Jesus is saying here on the cross. I give you to each other. Holy smokes. I read a blog written by Mike Frost entitled Jesus Wasn't Big on the Biological Family. Okay. It's when you think about the history of the church and certain streams of our spiritualities and certain movements of the church, man, we have made the nuclear family bigger than life itself. So Mike Frost writes this sermon, really, on Jesus Wasn't Big on the Biological Family. And so I read this thing. And so I take a snippet for you. Here he says this, and it's better than I would say it. So I'm quoting Brother Mike. He says, into a cold, brutal Roman Empire where all men had three wives at their disposal, where orphans and widows were as good as dead, where sojourners and strangers were not welcome, Jesus calls into being from the cross and along the way, I would say, a whole new social order. And it is to be embodied in the Christian community, what we now call the congregation. Jesus, though he had done this before, if you read the Gospels, numerous times actually, Jesus has redefined the word, the idea, the reality of family. So, and also into a nation. Some would say that the nation Israel was obsessed with the biological families. The attention they gave to genealogies and bloodlines, to the study of those, the way the religious leaders would almost talk about grace, the grace of God flowing through the blood of your father, right? If you were kin, then you were in on God, right? Okay, Jesus was having none of that. So much more, as so often we find in Jesus, it is so much more when it comes to what constitutes a family, the covenant of love founded by Jesus, lived in Jesus, is what bonds us, what makes us family. Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. We are given to each other. And if there ever was a day for this word, it is today. This week, we acknowledged, right, the 1-year anniversary of when we became aware here where we live, territory treaty number one, where we live in our province, of the pandemic that was spreading across the globe. If there ever was a year that the light has shone upon how vulnerable we are, vulnerable in our health, both our physical health, our aging health, our mental health, our financial health, our relational health. If there ever was a time when the light has made glaringly clear how vulnerable we are, it's another paradox, because how vulnerable and fragile is our human life, and yet how resilient we are at the same time. Okay, but that's a sermon for another day, the paradox of the divine creation of humanity. And though, as opposed to in Jesus' day, we have more social, what we call social nets now, and they caught some, and I give thanks to God for all the people who every day made sure people didn't fall through, right? Who caught people, who saw people, and made sure they were going to be okay. I would suggest today, based upon this particular teaching throughout the life of Jesus, and now him just kind of bringing it right there into the spotlight of the cross, that the safety nets that are most important for each other are the ones we weave together. Not only providing the basics for people, provisions, but so much more. What we need to live life and what we need to follow, what we need for our following of Jesus, both individually and as congregations and as the worldwide church. We are given to each other. And that reality of new family is embodied in our congregations. And you know, it's God is funny. I don't know if you find that. I have 2 minutes. I find the Spirit. So it was my time in life to preach on this passage. And it's been also in this season of life, in my own journey, the Spirit has said to me a number of times, Kathy, you need to take more seriously that the church is your family. And that calls for responsibility on my part, attention, energy, and engagement. And I, as a child of the church, as a woman in the church, have actually received a low lot of loving and investment by the church. And I think now the Spirit is saying to me, Kathy, the very things you have so deeply experienced, I want you to embody in a deeper way. So may the Spirit also speak to you wherever you are at in your following, in your discipleship, in the season of life you are in. It ebbs and flows. But may you hear from this word of Scripture what the Spirit is saying to you as a community, as a Sterling Mennonite Fellowship, and what is saying to your household, you who live together there, and what it is saying to you in all the spaces where you see people and all the ways that you share your life, energy, and gifts with the body of Christ. We are given to each other. It's mind-blowingly beautiful. It's a beautiful way of life. Thanks be to God. And I have 18 seconds. That's all. Anyway, thank you. May the Spirit give you what you need for this day and for the days yet to come.
Thank you, Kathy. Thank you for bringing us deeper into the words of Jesus. And we also pray God's blessing on you as you continue to minister to us in Mennonite Church, Manitoba, and as you minister to your family, as you described, nuclear and beyond, the family that God gives to each other. So we thank you so much for joining us. We're going to just hear a song. Byron's going to lead us in a song as we reflect more on Kathy's words. And then we're going to go into our time of sharing. So if you want, you can already in the chat enter any prayer requests or things that you would like the church to know, and we'll share, do some sharing time after. So Byron, go ahead and lead us.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning. Thou changest not, but as thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer. springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, joined with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy help hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new blessings I see. All I have needed, thy help hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Thank you, Byron. It worked okay. But what's important is that we heard the and saw the words of the song. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto us. And so let's take a moment of sharing together the ways in which God has been faithful and the ways in which we are feeling. All right. Welcome back, everybody. Hope it was a good chance to connect with folks and catch up a bit. We're going to just close our service off and then keep things open. If you want to stick around, if you have to go, that is fine too. I'm going to speak our benediction. And then we're unsure about Byron's internet connection. So let's try it and see if it works. And if not, we can try something else. But take this benediction with you as we go from our service and our time together. As we go from this virtual place, may we know that we are seen by God. Your being, your hopes, your losses, your struggles, and your joys are seen by God. Let us remember that we are given to one another, and may we live into the covenant of love that comes from Christ. Amen. And go in peace.
You are the light of the world, O Lord, and you make your servants shine. So how could there be any darkness in me if you are the light of the world? You are the light of the world. You are the bread of life, O Lord, broken to set us free. So how could there be any hunger in me? You are the bread of life. You are the bread of life. Wipe every tear away, O Lord. Give us a song of the Lamb. Promise is true, but it's still up to you to wipe every tear away. Wipe every tear away. You overcome the world, O Lord, and given us victory. So how could I fear when trouble is near? Cause you've overcome the world. You've overcome the world.
Thank you to all who were involved in our service this morning. And again, go in peace, and we'll hope to see you soon, and stick around if you would like to still catch up and chat. Take care.